always shared a common wonder about the universe. In fact, since the beginning of history, the quest to discover its laws and mysteries has been the motivation behind much of mankind's doing. To know and be in unity with the true reality of God, man, the universe.
Hold faithfulness and sincerity as first principle.
Shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it.
Where there is charity and wisdom, there is neither fear nor ignorance.
Adultery and hypocrisy have ample wages, but truth goes with begging. Here I stand.
We hold these truths to be self-evident. That all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator.
It is difficult to make a man miserable while he feels he is worthy of himself and claims kindred to the great God.
Religion without science is blind. Science without religion.
Ask not what your country can do for you.
No man is free if he fears death. But the minute you conquer the fear of death at that moment, you are free.
And often in proclaiming what they discovered, many in history suffered tremendous persecution, usually from no authority other than ignorance. Of this generation, science's quest provided us with a fulfillment of age-old dreams and even some unexpected surprises.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Part of the real miracle in getting to the moon was for the first time being able to see the Earth. There, at that moment, technology gave to us a vision before seen only by poets and visionaries. No more doubts. We are all living and dying there. And we have come to think with a new consciousness about the whole Earth as our common home. As never before in history, we can now see that the violation of unchanging moral, spiritual, and ecological laws of the universe ultimately results in our own violation.
Transformations that take place in our society and the new vision of self that has arisen in society and the sense of self-fulfillment that tends to be very often egotistical and selfish. Our materialist society, our consumerist society, has led to an expectation of immediate gratification, of doing our own thing, of self-gratification, self-realization, just looking at self. And there's been a disappointment. This does not fulfill human beings. But in many ways, this is a spiritual vacuum. It's a spiritual search which is now underway. Certainly there's necessity of not only more spiritual training, but more spiritual inspiration, more conversion of the heart and conversion of the soul to God and to each other in love and service of each other because of God. There's no question about it that much more of this is needed. After all, Jesus said, be you perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. So we have a great goal to aim at, certainly. Hope must be in a community. We can only be full human persons and realize ourselves by the give and take and the love and service of the community experience. Whether that's a religious community, and I think a religious dimension to community experience is very essential, because then you get basic meaning in life, absolute values from which to root your motivation. But we need to lead forth these values into broader society as well.
It is with a similar understanding of the problems of the world and a similar belief in the spiritual laws governing the power of love that so many in history have sought the moral and spiritual renewal of civilization.
But what can military might and economic strength do if a nation loses its moral and spiritual values?
Precisely this purpose is what motivated the Reverend Sun Myung Moon, who in the early 50s began the Unification Church with a small group in his native country, war-torn Korea. The spirit of the church, a head to know, a heart to feel, a hand to serve, caught the imagination of people everywhere. The Reverend Moon came to the United States in 1972. He believes that America is chosen to renew a covenant with God and to be an example of civic virtue and social justice. In this film, we will take a look at a few of the programs and projects inspired by this man.
So faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. I think everyone is aware that the highest religion is love. It's the main point of all the great religions in the world. But I'd like to talk a little bit about love in really a social context this morning. And a very fundamental part of that social context is the family. How love is exercised in the family becomes extremely important to the society. For us, of course, the family is something different. It's not merely the basic unit of society, but the family exists for us as the basic unit of the kingdom of heaven. And we call that family the God-centered family.
As well as regular church services, the members of the church believe that God should dwell in the home 365 days a year.
That's why throughout the world, wherever Unification Church members are living, wherever they're working, whether it's in Europe or Asia, in South America, here in the United States, in every city, each member of the Unification Church will kind of adopt 360 homes. And we'll try to find ways of helping the families, doing babysitting or washing the dishes, helping with the housework, taking care of the elderly people, doing whatever can be done to improve the quality of life for the families living within that area. And we believe that as these 360 home areas multiply, and as the Spirit of God can dwell within those homes, then this can affect the overall society so that we can really see the nations and eventually the whole world come closer to the realization of God's ideal.
Unification theology encourages members to actively participate in community service and volunteerism. Minority Alliance International is a charitable project of the Unification Church formed to promote the rights of all racial, religious, national, and ethnic minorities. It serves as an umbrella organization sponsoring civil rights work worldwide. Other projects which are sponsored or partially funded by the church include the National Council for Church and Social Action, which promotes dialogue and cooperation among different denominations to provide social services for poor communities. In the United States, church members founded Project Volunteer, an unique organization which utilizes volunteers to redistribute millions of pounds of food and other materials to a recipient network of hundreds of community-based charitable organizations in major cities across the United States. Founded in California in 1975, where abundant harvests yield massive quantities of surplus food, food which would be destroyed or buried, Project Volunteer feeds thousands of needy families weekly, often in exchange for their volunteer services. The distribution of goods to foreign nations is done by the church-sponsored International Relief Friendship Foundation. Acting as a sister organization to Project Volunteer, IRFF is active in over 52 countries, most of them in the Third World. Here in 1981, a desperately needed IRFF shipment of foodstuffs arrives in Zaire, Africa. Accompanying the food was over a ton of medical supplies and the foundation's own European medical team, which worked for 3 months as volunteers at hospitals and medical centers. Besides treating patients, the team advised families on hygiene and nutrition. And in Tokyo, the church recently founded Ishin Hospital, a fully equipped facility with 9 wards. The hospital also maintains a permanent medical team in Thailand, 2 rural clinics in Japan, and annual medical missions to Korea and Okinawa. In 1975, missionary teams went out to over 120 nations. Each team was comprised of a member from Europe, America, and the Orient. Their purpose, to serve, teach, and set an example of international cooperation. Traditional missionary work, there are other more unique forms of outreach by the church. One such innovative branch is Ocean Church. Here, the sea is seen as a refreshing place to commune with God, to seek spiritual as well as physical nourishment. Members of Ocean Church focus their activities on those communities whose sustenance and future lie with the sea. In the spirit of outdoor character development seminars, Ocean Church developed what it dubbed Ocean Challenge, a religious education experience via tuna fishing. Universities throughout the free world, church members help to organize a campus ministry known as CARP, the Collegiate Association for the Research of Principles. Its primary goals are to provide a creative alternative to communism and a revitalization of morality. CARP publishes a national student weekly called The World Student Times. In 1968, the Reverend Moon founded the International Cultural Foundation, and for the past 10 years, it has sponsored the International Conference on the Unity of the Sciences. This conference annually brings together hundreds of distinguished scientists and scholars out of diverse fields of study from around the world. The conference provides a forum regarding the search for absolute values, the redirection of today's misused technology, and multidisciplinary solutions to global problems.
The unification of the church is the base for the unification of mankind.
For members of the church throughout the world, theology plays an integral role.
Under the unity of God.
Education is provided, among other places, at the Unification Theological Seminary in Barrytown, New York. Established in 1975, an ecumenical staff of professors teaches the theological tenets of each of their own various denominations. A library of over 25,000 volumes is central to the seminary. The seminary also sponsors the new Ecumenical Research Association. Made up of more than 500 international theologians and philosophers, the conference meets regularly to discuss topics such as new religions, millennial traditions, and most recently one titled God, a Contemporary Discussion.
Surrounding the reality of God is a subject of fundamental importance to the future of humankind.
Beyond dialogue, the church realizes the remarkable power of the arts to convey an ideal. In 1974, the Little Angels School for the Performing Arts was established in Seoul, Korea. The school provides a full range of education, as well as training young men and women in classical music, theater, and dance. With enrollment topping 3,600 students in 1981, the school has become a showcase for the entire Korean nation. In 1975, the church purchased New York City's Old Manhattan Center. Besides the historical opera house now under renovation, the building contains the largest audience participation TV studio in New York. Numerous other cultural groups have been founded or are sponsored by the church. Among them are the New Hope Singers International, the New York City Symphony, Sunburst, a popular music band, the New World Players, seen here in their recent production of Godspell. The Go World Brass Band. The Revival Dancers. And the Little Angels Folk Ballet. Seen here in one of their stunning performances, the troupe, formed in 1963, has performed for audiences around the globe, including command performances for the United Nations, as well as 35 heads of state. The church also encourages individual creativity. Swiss-born sculptor Alois Lang specializes in wood carving. And artists Jan Parker and Shigeyoshi Watanabe work in their studio high above Manhattan. At a Sunday service in New York City, Dr. Mose Durst, president of the American Church, delivers a sermon entitled, Peace.
we find in the Bible is the full range of human experience in relationship to God. The quest to know God, the doubt of one's own knowing, the celebration of the experience of God, and the anger when one falls away from that experience of God. If we are to walk along the spiritual path, we have to understand the obstacles that we must overcome. If we are at peace, the world has hope for peace. It is not the size of the table in Geneva that offers us the hope for peace, and it is not the many tongues that move on the East River of New York that is the hope for peace. It is the heart within each of us that must open to God in that primal encounter and then reach out to each other in the secondary encounter.
Let us pray.
At a time when the authority of the religious voice is so much in question, the Unification Church seeks to reaffirm the importance of classic spiritual values. The value of man as a divine creation. The value of the family as the most important building block of a good society. The value of community service to establish a healthy nation. The value of a nation's living for the benefit of the world before its own interests. And above all, the value and law of love as the altar, purpose, and cornerstone of all relationships.
As you can see, I am just an ordinary man. Not too tall, and not too handsome. All my wife thinks I am. Thank you. Many people ask me, Reverend Moon, why are you involved with the unity of sciences. You are a minister of God, aren't you? My answer is yes. I am a minister of God. That's why I am interested in this unity of sciences. God is only the oldest preacher, and he is also the number one scientist. That's true.
The Reverend Sun Myung Moon, founder and spiritual leader of the Unification Church, an inspiration for the programs we have seen, always has spoken of one primary goal, the age-old quest of a peaceful world centered on God.
I like you.
Thank you.
I only want to offer a brief...
In December of 1981, 170 leaders from the world's major religious traditions met in Hawaii to discuss the central theological perspectives on God which underscore all religions. While at the conference, many participants asked if a similar kind of event could be held for students so that they too could have such a broadening experience with world religions. In presenting their request to the Reverend Sun Myung Moon, founder of the Unification Church, who himself had previously expressed the need for such a youth seminar, the idea was not only well received, it was expanded. Today, the Youth Seminar on World Religion is an annual international pilgrimage whose purpose is rooted deeply in the ideal of world peace through religious harmony and dialogue. This film is a brief account of the first two seminars, which took place in the summers of 1982 and 83. And traverse all the different ways once. Wherever I look, I see men quarreling in the name of religion. So were the words of the Hindu teacher Ramakrishna 100 years ago, and perhaps never so important as in today's quest for world peace. Precisely for this reason, each summer over 150 students and scholars, chosen for their academic excellence and moral character, convene in Barrytown, New York, to begin a seminar of unprecedented scope. The seminar is based on several convictions. First, that the fundamental nature of each person is spiritual, divine, and that spiritual values need to be promoted and understood as an alternative to materialistic ideologies. And secondly, they believe that if the religious peoples of the world are given a broader understanding of each other's religious traditions, they could contribute significantly to the establishment of world peace.
An incredible opportunity. I do not know, nor have I spoken to anyone who knows, of any other adventure in which so many people from so many different religious backgrounds and from so many different countries embark on this kind of spiritual pilgrimage.
And I'm going to begin by talking about the world, its religious aspect as a whole, with no divisions.
We are equally proud that we have you. We are proud that we have these participants who are prepared to go out in the world, expose themselves and be exposed to the different cultures and different traditions of the world.
Thus, these pilgrims representing over 30 nations and every major religion embarked upon 7 weeks of spiritual searching. Their purpose? To understand the religions of man firsthand through the hearts and minds of the people who live them. Their agenda? The great religious centers of the world. First stop, Israel. Here, as in each of the countries to follow, the group visited the significant religious sites.
To Qumran, or to the desert, to the wilderness, to confess and to repent. To repent means, in Hebrew, tshuva. It means to change their roads, to change their ways.
The Jordan begins above the Sea of Galilee, in this area up here, near what is today the northern border of Israel.
Which the Bible tells us which is Bethlehem. In Jeremiah, we're told that when the Jews were being led off to exile, Rachel, a voice would be heard.
In the day we did karub, and in the night we had snow. It means that it was in the summertime. Karub is ripe only in the summertime. While it was snow in the night, it means it was very cold, even in the nights of the summer. This is the desert.
Jerusalem, golden crown of the Holy Land, sacred to Jew, Christian, and Muslim. Says one Hebrew proverb, 10 measures of beauty came into the world. Jerusalem received 9 measures, and the rest of the world won.
We had a tour of old Jerusalem, and through the tour, the guide took us to the Western Wall, the Western Wailing Wall. There also, I saw some Jewish rabbis, other people praying, you know, at the Western Wall. Well, I decided just to go and join them. And I stood beside a rabbi, even though I didn't understand what he was saying, you know, what he was singing. I really stood close beside him and just tried to do the same to and fro movement. And I really felt that something is also happening. I just cannot describe it. I think one has to experience it before he can tell others what he has felt.
Here also on the old site of the Jewish temple rests the noble enclosure of Islam, the Haram es Sharif, with its stately dome of the rock. Here, Jewish tradition maintains, Abraham was to have sacrificed his son Isaac. And here, Muslim tradition claims, Muhammad ascended into heaven. Here indeed were the crossroads of human history, the streets which echoed the warnings of the prophets, the tyranny of Rome, and the parables of the teacher Jesus, who tearfully climbed their stones to Golgotha.
I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome you to the Youth Seminar on World Religions 1983, Israel, and to our first public program.
Besides the ongoing series of lectures given in each country, public programs such as this one were considered an integral component of the seminar. A panel of guest speakers from local religious and academic communities came to discuss their views on the theme, world peace through religious dialogue and harmony.
Adam sinning in the Adam and Eve and the sin in the Garden of Eden and the punishment, they're banished from the garden.
For me, this was a return to Jerusalem. I had been here 6 years before. In many ways, I saw what I had seen before, but it took on a new light. This visit for me caused a great deal of introspection on my part. It was the people that I met, rather than the places that I saw, that really meant the most to me. And it made me wonder whether the degree of Judaism that I practice was enough, because in their eyes, it isn't. And I know that in some way I'm going to have to react to this questioning that I've been doing.
Tour headed deeper into the world of Islam. In 1982, they went to Cairo, Egypt, with its pyramids and ocean of turrets and minarets. And in 1983, the second tour went to Istanbul, Turkey.
The first city excavated till our age, right in the middle of the Anatolia, changed the history books to be rewritten again, which will be the third time in our age. in the last 60 years, three times, history books are rewriting because of the findings in Anatolia. You may be interested why, what I mean, because most of the art historians showing this edifice as the most beautiful edifice of the history of art.
To theologians, it is not surprising to find Islam the most socially vocal of the Middle Eastern religions. Westerners, who define religion in terms of personal experience, are very difficult to understand by the Muslims, whose religion calls them to establish a very explicit kind of social order. To the Muslim, faith and politics, religion and society, are inseparable. Istanbul also serves as a center for Eastern Orthodox Christianity. While there, the seminar was fortunate enough to be granted an audience with Demetrius I, His All Holiness, the Ecumenical Patriarch of the Eastern Orthodox Church.
Our dear visitors to the Ecumenical Patriarchate, which is the center of the whole Orthodoxy. Because this center wishes to be and believes that it is not only in name but also in reality ecumenical.
Italy, progeny of Hellenism, womb of the Renaissance, citadel of Christianity.
The third fresco beyond that arch is a famous one of Francis preaching to the birds. The next one is a stigmatization. Francis received the wounds of Christ. These scenes correspond to the way Francis suffered with Christ in his life. On this side we have the passion of Christ. On this side we have Francis suffering with Christ and for Christ. It is the compassion of Saint Francis.
I mean, I had read a lot before I came, and I was really looking forward to going to Italy. And I did understand why it was so important to the Christians, why Rome was so important, or why it had a special significance for the Christians. And I, of course, I myself did feel something very, very nice inside me when I saw the Pope. I had to stand very far behind. He had something about him. I could say that I did understand more about Christianity once I reached there. And this time I could feel it among the people.
The Hindus themselves would refer to their religion as Sanatana Dharma. If you understand the word Dharma, you understand all of Indian civilization. Because in this one word is encapsulated the history and the religious aspirations of these people from antiquity. Sanatana meaning eternal. It is the religion of eternal law. It is a universal religion.
I had heard a lot about India, about its great spiritual tradition, but I learned a great deal about Hinduism, and throughout the lecture and the talking with Professor Crawford, who gave a really good insight in the way in which psychology and religion are related in a very harmonious way in Hinduism, and that was something that struck me very greatly and that I was very interested in.
Hinduism has shared her land for centuries with Parsis, Buddhists, Muslims, Sikhs, and Christians may help one to understand her conviction that the various major religions are relatively equal paths to the same God. Nepal, a land where Buddhism and Hinduism are one and the same.
the world now and then seems very beautiful and very comfortable. At the present moment for this group, we are surrounded by both beauty and comfort. But in fact, the world is full of what Buddhists call dukkha, which is sometimes translated suffering, but a much better word is frustration.
It's my first encounter with seeing Buddhism practiced. I read about it academically at school, and I was very, very amazed at the way that the ideals that are expressed are actually practiced in Buddhism, especially Nepal affected me because it was the first place where I saw a culture that adapts Buddhism and actually lives it. They have maybe two main goals in Buddhism, to develop one's inner wisdom and to practice compassion towards all living beings and their environment. I saw these two things being done in a very simple human way.
The seminar again traveled eastward to China, the historical center of Confucianism.
Now coming directly to teaching of Confucius. As I've told you, he believed in a moral order called Tian, which is never specified in detail, because I think Confucius was wise enough to know that a human being cannot know the nature of the universe, or at least cannot express the whole of it.
Most of all, I was deeply impressed by the warmth of all of the people of all the countries we visited, more so the Orientals. I think that their background in Buddhism and Confucianism and Taoism is very well integrated into their everyday lives. Even in communist China, I was really surprised to see such warmth and such caring and loving people. The government has really not allowed them to be so open and friendly towards outsiders. I saw how generous the people are, and again, I contribute that to the Buddhist background and the Confucianist background as well.
From China, it was on to Seoul, Korea, the final stop of the pilgrimage.
Cities and places in the world that claim to be a melting pot of world regions. But in Korea alone, five regions, Buddhism, Confucianism, Christianity, Shamanism, and new religions are almost equally alive today. No other nation that is equally divided into four or five different religious groups today.
집회를 하고 온 적이 있습니다. 14명의 선교사가 모였습니다만은 그 선교사들의
In the sight of God, there are no such things as denominations or religious differences. Rather, all of us, no matter what our religious persuasion, should work together in creating harmony and establishing the kingdom of God on this earth. The farewell program included performances by the Little Angels Folk Ballet, practically a national treasure in itself.
Dear friends, I think it's the most appropriate word. How many things we have done together during the past weeks. Remember, we climbed upon Masada, the Nepalese hills, the Great Wall. We weren't afraid to descend in the Ezekiah tunnel, the catacombs, the tunnels at the 38th parallel. We went to shrines and places of worship of many religious traditions. Deep impressions have been flowing into our minds and our souls. No, we will go back to our respective countries and homes, but that is not really the end of the travel, because now will begin for each of us the time of personal and peaceful reflections about our experiences and our discoveries during this summer. Actually, can't we think now that the unity of religions does already exist, not superficially, not immediately recognizable, but in depth? The dogmas of the various religions describe aspects of the same universal truth, which is much higher than human words can express. As this seminar comes to its end, it's also time to express our feelings of gratitude to all the people who made it a success and an unforgettable experience. We all feel deeply indebted to Reverend Sun Myung Moon for giving us this unique opportunity.
And so the pilgrims flew away to the continuing adventure of their lives, taking with them what they had learned and what they had become.
Do you, as an ideal husband and wife, pledge to establish an eternal family with which God can be happy?
그대들은 하늘의 전통을 이어받아 영원한 선의 부모로서 가정과 세계의 기법이 되는 자녀를 양육할 것을 맹세하나며.
Do you pledge to inherit heavenly tradition? And as the external parents of goodness, raise up your children to be the examples of this standard before the family and the world.
Yes. 성령이 성립된 것을 선포하나이다. Amen.
I proclaim that these 2,075 couples are wedded before God, the true parents, the world, and the universe on July 1st, 1982.
What a beautiful couple. He's so handsome and she's so beautiful. Their lives should be beautiful.
Izzy got married.
There you go. First slice. Yay.
We were in Korea, so
7 years ago, and at that time we didn't have any of our family or friends with us, but we had many other people. We were also married with 1,800 couples. Even though we were married with 1,800 couples, it just feels as special to you as it must to everyone else there. It's just a very, very special, wonderful feeling.
The feeling is what I would expect the people of Israel might have felt if Moses could have officiated at their wedding 4,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago, what it would feel to a Christian to have Jesus himself officiating, or what it would mean to a Buddhist to have Buddha himself involved as God's representative in the ceremony. From our point of view, Reverend Moon is such a person.
The marriage of Reverend and Mrs. Moon in 1960 was the first wedding, actually the first blessing in all our Unification Church history. And we believe that this marriage is actually the foundation for God's blessing of all mankind. Each wedding that followed got larger and larger and symbolized an ever-widening circle of God's blessing flowing out to the world.
36 couples, 72, 124, 430, and then in 1970, over 777 couples were married.
We were blessed that day 12 years ago in Seoul, Korea. This is us on our wedding day.
It was so overwhelming, and just the whole experience was just something sacred.
As important for us, as Reverend Moon has said, as the salvation of a whole nation. The last major blessing was in Seoul, Korea, of 1,800 couples in 1975.
Before the wedding, we had a rehearsal at Madison Square Garden.
Don't cut corner short on the left. Go around Mrs. Rapkins. You're cutting your corner short. Go up to the edge and make a square corner, please.
I'm sure that most people were thinking about, of course, the next day. Many of the members, you know, had been members of the Unification Church for several years.